How do you do, everyone? This is Hank Weaver. For the past year, this signature has announced the opening of Disneyland, the show. Now, it announces the opening of Disneyland, the place. The people and eyes around the world are focused on these 160 acres here in Anaheim, California. This afternoon, Disneyland, the world's most fabulous kingdom, will be unveiled before an invitational world premiere, and you are guests. Art Linkletter will be your host, and with ABC crews and cameras on the spot, will guide you through this truly magic land.
That's Mickey Mouse, the inimitable little character that started this whole story with Walt Disney 25 years ago, perhaps the most popular motion picture star in Hollywood. I'm standing here on the railroad tracks with helicopters roaring overhead and cars parking by the thousands, and I'm in front of the big Disneyland and Santa Fe Railroad station. And down these tracks, in just a couple of seconds, will come Walt Disney himself, barreling in a railroad train built to 5/8 miniature size. Well, this job in the next hour or a half is going to be a delight. I feel like Santa Claus with a $17 million bundle of gift packages all wrapped in whimsy and sent your way over television with the help of 29 cameras, dozens of crews, and literally miles and miles of cable. Now, of course, this is not so much a show as it is a special event. The rehearsal went about the way you'd expect a rehearsal to go if you were covering three volcanoes all erupting at the same time and you didn't expect any of them. So, from time to time, if I say we take you now by camera to the snapping crocodiles in Adventureland, and instead somebody pushes the wrong button and we catch Irene Dunne adjusting her bustle on the Mark Twain, don't be too surprised. It's all in fun, and that's what we're here for. The grounds are loaded with about 15,000 people who are especially invited guests of Walt Disney's. And they're here from movie land, from motion picture and correspondence, from every possible kind of activity connected with the opening of the eighth wonder of the world. In fact, I think I'll get off these tracks right now and go over and meet some of the people here waiting for the train to come in. And since this is a family affair, I thought you might be interested in seeing the rest of the Linkletters who are all gathered around me. And to show you exactly what happens now, I let them all take a little vote. Diane, you're six. Where would you like to go of all the places in Disneyland? Pick anyone.
To the great big castle where Sleeping Beauty is.
Oh, you want to go to the castle. Sharon, you're eight. What would you like to see?
I think I'd like to go to see Frontierland when Davy Crockett fights the Indians.
Davy Crockett. Robert, what would you like to see?
I want to take the boat trip down the Congo.
And Dawn?
I think I'll take a cruise to the moon in the rocket ship over at Tomorrowland.
And Jack?
I want to see Bob Cummings.
Oh, Bob Cummings. Lois, you take them all to wherever they want to go. Bob Cummings, come on in here.
I'm so glad your son said that.
Yeah, you know Bob's going to help out here in jumping all over the grounds, describing the various things. And
that's
where do you
right
go up. First?
Well, I go down on Main Street here and go into an old-fashioned car called a Premier, and I'll be seeing you.
In a couple of minutes.
Fine.
Ronnie Raegan, come on in.
Yeah, how about that son of yours? I've been buttering up to him all morning, hoping he'd say that about me.
Isn't this a riot today?
Oh, it certainly is.
And, Ron, your first job is down here in the town square.
Right out here in front of the depot, yes, for the Main Street.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, right about now, Walt Disney aboard the E.P. Ripley, the miniature Santa Fe Disneyland Railroad train, should be barreling around the outskirts of this tremendous and fantastic spot. It's a mile and a quarter track, and it's a trip that's out of this world, because inside that circle is a brand new eighth wonder of the world. First, there's Adventureland. Yes, a visit by boat to remote and adventurous regions of the world. Then, of course, there's Tomorrowland. The time is 1986 there. The place is a city of the future, where a trip to the moon is an everyday thing. Then there's Frontierland. Ah, that's a visit to America's historic past with Davy Crockett himself there. A legendary land made real. Fantasyland. Well, this is really the theme symbol of the whole Disneyland and the thing nearest and dearest to Walt Disney's heart. Hey, how are you? That's Danny and his gang and representatives of the press. Thousands are coming in. They're going through the magic tunnel on foot because no car can enter here. And like Alice in Wonderland, as you go on through that tunnel past the Disneyland Santa Fe, you find yourself in a bygone time. Another world. The clock has turned back a half a century, and you're in the main square of a small American town, the year 1900. take a look around. There's the City Hall, quaint and dignified with its post office, the place where the citizens of the town gather to exchange gossip and hear the latest news of the day. Fire station, that's a special interest to the Volunteer Bucket Brigade, whose horse-drawn engine and up-to-date hose and chemical wagon are a source of real local pride. Then there's the car barn housing the horse-drawn streetcar, a great boon to speedy transportation, and that little old streetcar will be going up and down Main Street here in Disneyland about every 10 or 15 minutes, day in and day out. It goes by a whole flock of very interesting and quaint little stores. There's the Emporium, where a lady could buy Lyle stockings or a silver button hook, or for a dollar, the new pair of tan high-button shoes. Main Street, USA, and every one of those buildings is 5/8 real size. The doorways, of course, and the windows are full size, but the buildings themselves are 5/8. The people you see up and down the street, however, are full-size people. They were not made by Walt Disney. The old-time music shop should be in there somewhere. If you were a courting a gal, that's where you buy your mandolin or your banjo and start tuning it up for the Sunday canoe ride. Oh, you kid, 23 skidoo. The town square is where the band holds forth, and those free band concerts were one of the big social highlights of the week, any week. Or the Grand Opera House, where a Jenny Lind or a Chautauqua lecture might take place. And if you were daring, you might go out with your girl for a ride in an 1898 locomobile, the hot rod of its day. The E.P. Ripley is rolling around the Santa Fe Disneyland railroad tracks with Walt Disney at the controls. And in the cab with him, you may be surprised to know, is the governor of the state of California and the president of Santa Fe, Mr. Gurley himself. And in the cars behind the 5/8 size train, you'll see the little boys and girls dressed in the foreign costumes of their countries, because they are the children of the foreign consuls located here in Los Angeles. Now, the track is a mile and a half around. The train runs about every 10 or 12 minutes. In fact, there are two trains. There's a passenger train and there's a freight train. And each one can take several hundred passengers. It takes about 6 minutes to go around the track, which is built on a ramp that completely encircles Disneyland and cuts it out from the outside world. So once you get inside Disneyland, all you see are the various kingdoms. Now, if you look on down the track, you see Mickey Mouse there at the controls. And that's an exact duplicate of the engines that ran over 50 years ago. You can see the conductor there with his brass buttons glistening in the sun, the arms of the children. Hello, Walt. Hello, Governor.
Hi.
Boy, how did the run go?
Oh, fine. The governor had her around through Frontierland, and then Fred Gurley there, he took her around. I picked her up and brought her in. Highballing in, boy.
Hello, Walt. Governor.
Glad to see you, Art.
Governor Knight of California, ladies and gentlemen, and Walt Disney, of course, and Mr. Gurley, the president of the Santa Fe.
And of the Santa Fe and Disneyland, if you please.
That's right. Now,
Vice President of the Santa Fe and Disneyland.
You gentlemen have lots to do down in the square, so we'll see you at the dedication.
Bye. Thank you, Art.
All right, there they go.
Center of Main Street, ready for the official opening ceremony. All activity in Main Street has ceased. Those carriages which have lined up for the parade to follow are full of celebrities. Walt Disney, Governor Knight, the mayor of Anaheim, and other dignitaries are talking to the three chaplains representing the Protestant, Catholic, and Jewish faiths. And now, Walt Disney will step forward to read the dedication of Disneyland.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future. Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America, with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world. Thank you.
Military chaplains representing the various creeds are present. but all were agreed that
it
would be most fitting.
I have known Walt Disney for many years and have long been aware of the spiritual motivation in the heart of this man who has dreamed Disneyland into being. Let us join with him, then, in dedicating these wonder-filled acres to those things dear to his heart and ours, to understanding and goodwill among men, laughter for children, memories for the mature, and aspiration for young people everywhere. And beyond the creeds that would divide us, let us unite in a silent prayer that this and every worthy endeavor may prosper at God's hand. Let us bow in prayer. Amen.
That was Walt Disney's nephew, the Reverend Glenn D. Pewter. And now, the Honorable Goodwin
Thank
Knight,
you,
Governor
Ronald
of
Reagan,
California.
Mr. and Mrs. Disney, Reverend clergy, and my fellow Americans. Today is a wonderful day, and all America is proud as we open Disneyland. This is a wondrous community with all the charm of the old world and all of the progress and ingenuity of the new world. Yes, this is a wonderful place for children and grown-ups alike. There are replicas of every town and city in America, stores, libraries, schools, just like your hometown, all built by American labor and American capital under the belief that this is a God-fearing and a God-loving country. And as we dedicate this flag now, we do it with the knowledge that we are the fortunate ones to be Americans, and that we extend to everyone everywhere the great ideals of Americanism, brotherhood, and peace on earth, goodwill towards men. Before you enter this realm, I'd like to read this dedication, which will be inscribed on a plaque. Frontierland, it is here that we experience the story of our country's past. The color, romance, and drama of frontier America as it developed from wilderness trails to roads, riverboats, railroads, and civilization. A tribute to the faith, courage, and ingenuity of our hardy pioneers who blazed the trails and made this progress possible.
And this is Frontierland. Inside this stockade, Walt Disney has created a frontier village that could have been carved out of the wilderness 100 years ago by the pioneers themselves. The flag flying over the stockade has 13 stars commemorating America's first period of independence.
Boat, something most living Americans have never seen. A popular boat up and down the Mississippi 50 years ago and more. And Walt Disney has built this great, big, beautiful, authentic stern wheel paddle boat from keel to smokestack. $250,000 worth of boat that hasn't been built in America for 50 years. Loaded with gay and carefree, happy passengers, a band playing up there in the second deck, which is the grand salon deck, all paneled in special woods, ready for the parties of the year. And incidentally, Walt Disney and his wife Lily celebrated their 30th anniversary last Wednesday, right here at a special party aboard the Mark Twain. But right now, it's my pleasure to introduce the lovely lady and famous star whom Mr. Disney has asked to christen the Mark Twain. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Irene Dunne. Hello, Irene.
Hello, how are you? My, it's listing.
It's listing a little because it'll be shoving off in a moment.
Yes, well, this is an authentic stern wheeler. Did you know that? 105 feet long.
Well, how do you know all this?
Well, you see, my father used to be supervising general of steamships in America, and my grandfather used to build boats like this.
I'll bet your dad would love to be here today, up there standing by the wheelhouse.
I can almost see him standing up there now with the captain alongside of him, just as though it were the greatest place in the world.
Well, now, Miss Dunne, you're holding a very special bottle here in your arms.
Yes, I am, Walt. You see, this bottle contains waters from all the leading rivers in America.
Brought here from all these towns by the great rivers.
That's right. So with these precious waters, I'm going to christen this boat the Mark Twain.
And there the boat is christened, and it starts on its daily trips up and down the rivers of the world. Of America, that is. Thank you, Miss Dunne.
Thank you.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, I've got other places to go. And the Commodore, Admiral Joe Fowler, up there in the wheelhouse, looks like they're getting ready to shove off. So I better... Goodbye, Irene. And goodbye, everybody. Have a good ride. There goes the whistle. Take her away, Admiral. Goodbye. Have a good trip.
Mark Twain as she gets ready to start on her maiden voyage. The Mark Twain, a proud symbol of that romantic era when whole cities grew out of river ports. The churning paddle wheels brought new people, new customs, and new industries to those fabulous ports of call, Pittsburgh, St. Louis, and Natchez. Riverboat even brought a new kind of music up the river from the city where the blues were born, where the Dixieland style was king. New Orleans. This is the Western Railway Station, and this is the CK Holiday, the Disneyland freight. And it's on its way now, leaving Frontierland and going 100 years into the future to Tomorrowland.
One minute from now, Walt Disney will present a preview of Tomorrowland and the fascinating world of the future in the year 1986.
Let's read these few words of dedication. A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievements. I thought I got a signal. Before our preview of Tomorrowland, I'd like to read these few words of dedication. A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievement, a step into the future with predictions of constructive things to come. Tomorrow offers new frontiers in science, adventure, and ideals. The atomic age, the challenge of outer space, and the hope for a peaceful and unified world.
Those doves are, ladies and gentlemen, I hope, the harbingers of peace for the world of tomorrow. And now, here in Disneyland, the year is 1986. That's way ahead. And that's when Halley's Comet will flash past the Earth again. And the time of its arrival will be recorded on a futuristic clock like this one here, which tells you, incidentally, at a glance, the exact time on any spot on the Earth. Yes, this is Tomorrowland. And it's not a stylized dream of the future, but a scientifically planned projection of future techniques by leading space experts and scientists. Now, whether you visit this spot, the spaceport of the future, to experience the thrills of a rocket trip to the moon, or perhaps you go to see the Circle-rama, that's a motion picture screen that completely encircles the audience, or perhaps this 70-foot model of a rocket-powered ship poised to blast off into outer space, you find yourself living predictions of things to come. Well, further out, just beyond here, next to Tomorrowland, is Autotopia, and that's the superhighway of the future. Art Linkletter will be along shortly to tell you all about it.
Now we're in Autopia, about a mile of superhighway adventure with all the kids lined up in little gasoline-driven automobiles that go whistling around the various freeway and highway convolutions at 11 miles an hour. These are gasoline-driven, and the kids can drive to their heart's content with their parents or without their parents. Where are you going? Oh, stay right there. I didn't know where you... I thought I was going to be run over here for a second.
Reserved for last. A few words of dedication for the happiest kingdom of them all, Fantasyland. Here is a world of imagination, hopes, and dreams. In this timeless land of enchantment, the age of chivalry, magic, and make-believe are reborn, and fairy tales come true. Fantasyland is dedicated to the young and the young in heart, to those who believe that when you wish upon a star, your dreams do come true.
This is Ronald Reagan again, and I'm very happy now to show you these young people. Since Disneyland opened, these children have been eagerly waiting to cross the moat for a wondrous trip through the Disney imagination. They'll be the first children to enjoy the Fantasyland rides, every one of which recreates the adventures of characters Walt has immortalized in films.
Fantasyland Castle, in the name of the children of the world.
This is Casey Jones, Jr., the famous little circus train.
Here we are at the Casey
with a
Jones,
big heart.
Jr. circus train. That's the little engine with a great big heart. And it has the calliope and the lion cage wagons and everything the kids ride in. And here are the DeFores. Don,
Missy,
and kids, you jump right in that wagon there.
And away we go. Wonderful.
Here's Margaret Whiting, a favorite songbird of mine. And you got your little sister, Barbara?
Yes, I do.
Gals, congratulations.
Thank you.
Marjorie Maine, are you going to take a ride? And let's go on down. Oh, look who the engineer is. If my eyes don't see me, Jerry Colonna.
What?
Are you the honorary engineer?
Why, yes.
And we're all aboard.
Take her away.
Junior Circus Special. And there they go. Jerry Colonna is highballing it. And the kids are getting aboard. That's enough. Let it go. Let it go. No more children. There they go. Goodbye, kids. Going to go out across the trestles and over the hills and by the canal. Look at, there are two of them up there, cutting over the many grades and many curves and hills which take them over this end of Fantasyland. And down below them are the canals. And in the canals go the various boats. And right now, I've got to get over to Mr. Toad's ride. So Bob Cummings, up on the pirate ship.
Take it,
Bob.
All right, Jim.
what would happen if we put and sat on there so you get down a little lower and get your head
I hear you.
Here
is a buck and here is the life of a private for me.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob Cummings again. I don't know whether the cameras are picking me up or not. They're simply marvelous. They've got Zumar lenses and they're a mile away. Of course, I'm on a real old-fashioned pirate ship, and sitting beside me is a man who's almost an authority on that, and his name, ladies and gentlemen, Bobby Driscoll. Hello,
Hi, Bob.
Bobby.
How are you today?
I'm just wonderful.
Isn't
and you?
Wonderful?
It's just great. You know, Bobby Driscoll starred in Walt Disney's Treasure Island, and that was some time ago when you were a little boy. You're grown up now, and quite an exciting thing. You never thought this would happen, did you?
No, it's just marvelous.
Isn't it wonderful,
just
though?
Terrific.
You know, looking at Fantasyland from where we are at this spot is simply fantastic.
See, the whole thing.
And, oh, and I see Art Linkletter right now. Art Linkletter is looking for a microphone. He looks all confused. He's standing over there in front of the Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. And I think if he ever gets a microphone, we'll be able to talk to him because he's waving his arms. There's been something gone wrong here for just an instant. But you can't wonder, ladies and gentlemen, this is a tremendous, tremendous affair today. 160 acres of fantasy. And it's just great. Now, here he comes with his microphone. He's coming out. Art Linkletter.
Mr. Disney's great picture, Wind in the Willows, inspires this ride, Mr. Toad, on a 1903 automobile. And believe me, this ride is the wildest of them all. The automobile goes through on a monorail, pursued through London town by police, crashing through walls, and finally goes in to a tunnel. And as you go into the railroad tunnel, you apparently see a train coming in the opposite direction. You can't turn. You can't escape. There's a tremendous collision head-on to the locomotive, and then I can't tell you the finish because I don't want to spoil it for you. This is the ride that not only parents should go with children, but the parents' parents should go with the parents. Danny Thomas, this is just the ride for you. Go on in. Oh, this is after that last ride. This one's easy.
A mild ride.
Yeah.
Gary?
Oh, nothing.
What is it?
Go on in.
Is it a mild ride?
It's an easy ride.
Well, let's go.
That's it. Just go right on
in. Like a merry-go-round?
Yeah, that's right.
Gary?
Come on, it's real easy, you said.
Sure. Bob Cummings up in the pirate ship. We're back to you, boy.
Oh, you're waiting for me? Oh, thank you. Everybody is waving at Bob Cummings over here, so I guess I'm back on. I'm on the top of the pirate ship, the Chicken of the Sea pirate ship, sitting right up here with Bobby Driscoll, and I think I can see coming now two of the most important people here at Fantasyland. The real star of it is Mickey and Minnie Mouse. And they're on their way, ladies and gentlemen. I can see them coming. There they go. And they're going into the Mickey Mouse Theater, a beautiful movie house which will have a continuous performance for children who visit Fantasyland.
Well, Walt, it seems to me we've been everywhere, haven't we?
Well, I hope so. I don't know.
Say, haven't we missed something?
Seems like it.
A whole land?
Adventureland.
Oh, that's my favorite. Let's go over there. Bob Cummings or somebody ought to be waiting to let us see that.
Well, we better hurry. We haven't got much time.
Take it away, Adventureland.
Well, this is Bob Cummings, ladies and gentlemen, again. And we are now at the beginning of a true life adventure into a still unconquered and untamed region of our own world. A Tahitian village where you can experience a slice of life as it exists in the paradise of the Pacific. And an African trading post, the spearhead of civilization in those primitive lands. Now, we're all loaded up, I believe. Thank you, Captain. You can take her off. We're ready for a ride down the tropical waterways of the world. Well, you just can't believe it, folks. The colors are so unbelievable. The banks are lined with rare trees and exotic foliage blown here from the far corners of the earth. in but a brief glimpse into this marvelous, marvelous network of Adventureland. But we haven't time now. We've got to take you back to see how the rest of the visitors at Disneyland are doing. So I take you back now to Dick Wesson. Take it over, friend.
Walt, you've made a bum out of Barnum today, but we've got to go.
I know, but I just want to say a word of thanks to all the artists, the workers, and everybody that helped make this dream come true.
Let's go into Fantasyland and have some fun.
Let's go.
Goodbye, folks.